Hello everyone, welcome back. In this video, we will be discussing WHO classification of bone tumors. So, bone tumors are classified into multiple categories and we will be discussing each category one by one. So, the first category includes chondrogenic tumors which are characterized by formation of cartilaginous matrix. And chondrogenic tumors include following subcategories which are osteochondroma and chondroma, chondromyxoid fibroma, chondroblastoma and chondrosarcoma. So except for the chondrosarcoma, which is a malignant chondrogenic tumor, rest all tumors are benign. So what is osteochondroma? Osteochondromas are basically bony outgrowths arising from the metaphysis of long bones or from flat bones. And osteochondromas can be sessile or pedunculated. They are covered by cartilaginous cap and thickness of the cartilaginous cap can be measured on MRI. And if it is more than 20 mm, it suggests development of chondrosarcoma. The growth of osteochondroma, it stops after 5-year fusion, but if the growth persists in adulthood, it again points towards malignancy. There is a condition in which multiple osteochondromas are seen and this condition is known as diaphyseal ectasia. Next is enchondroma, which are benign cartilaginous tumor, most commonly seen in the medullary cavity of long bones and in the short bones of hand and feet. And these tumors are characterized by osteolytic focus with internal cartilaginous mineralization. They are seen in all age groups and differential diagnosis includes bone and spark and low-grade chondrosarcoma. There is a condition in which multiple enchondromas are seen and this condition is known as Ollier disease. And in Ollier disease, if it is associated with presence of hemangioma, this situation is known as Maffucci syndrome. Next in the series is chondromyxoid fibroma, which is a rare benign chondrogenic tumor. It is most commonly seen in tibial metaphysis. It is eccentric and expansile in nature. It is seen in young adults and children and differential diagnosis include ABC, non-ossifying fibroma and fibrous dysplasia. Next is chondroblastoma, which is seen as a well-defined osteolytic lesion in the epiphysis of long bones in young adults and children. It is characterized by intense adjacent marrow edema, which can be seen on MRI. And chondroblastomas are generally seen as a painful and swollen joint. Next is chondrosarcoma, which is a malignant bone tumor that produces cartilaginous matrix. Chondrosarcomas are mostly seen in elderly patients and they are most commonly seen in the flat bones like scapula, ribs and iliac bones, but they can also be seen in the long bones. Chondrosarcoma can be primary or secondary because of dedifferentiation in osteochondromas and enchondromas. Chondrosarcomas are basically slow-growing tumors with metastasis in late stage. Next in the category include osteogenic tumors which are characterized by formation of osteous matrix. And osteogenic tumors include following subcategories which are osteoma, osteoblastoma, conventional osteosarcoma, telangiectatic osteosarcoma, periosteal osteosarcoma and periosteal osteosarcoma. So except for this osteosarcoma, the rest of the osteogenic tumors are benign. So what are osteomas? Osteomas are benign mature bony growths which are exclusively seen in the membranous bones like the skull and in the paranasal sinuses. So here we can see there is presence of a well-defined osseous growth in the left frontal sinus and this osteoma can cause blockage of the paranasal sinus and it can lead to formation of mucoses. Next is osteoid osteoma, which is seen as a lucent focus with surrounding sclerosis in the diaphysis of long bones and it can have a nidus which can have central calcification. They are mostly seen in the diaphysis of long bones, however, they are also reported in spine, small bones of hand and feet, and in patella. They are mostly seen in young adults and they are characterized by pain in night, which are typically relieved by acrylic blades. The treatment of choice is radiofrequency ablation under CT guidance. Next is osteoblastoma, which is a rare tumor with most common location in the posterior element of spine. in which it is characterized by lytic focus with extensive ossification. Next is conventional osteosarcoma, which is the most common primary malignant bone tumor in children. It is predominantly metaphyseal in location in the long bone and most commonly seen around the knee joint in 10 to 25 years of age. But we can have a second peak in more than 60 years of age. It can be purely lytic, but most commonly it is a combination of lytic and sclerotic areas. It can metastasize to lung and it has a poor prognosis. It can lead to cannonball metastasis in the lung and the patient can present with spontaneous pneumothorax. Next is telangiectatic osteosarcoma, which is an uncommon variant of osteosarcoma seen in adolescent population. It is characterized by presence of large blood-filled spaces separated by bony septa, and most commonly it is seen around knee joint, and because of presence of blood-filled spaces, it can have blue fluid level on MRI, which can simulate mimic aneurysmal bone cyst. Next is paraosteal osteosarcoma, which is a rare variant of osteosarcoma which arises from the surface of bone. It is mostly seen over the surface of bone, but in rare circumstances it can infiltrate into the marrow cavity. It is most commonly seen in the posterior aspect of distal femur. It is a slowly enlarging mass. It has a central dense ossification in contrast to myositis ossificans, which is its differential, in which we can have peripheral ossification. Whereas in paraosteal osteosarcoma, there is central ossification. In early stage of paraosteal sarcoma, we can have string sign, which is seen as a radiolucent line, which separates this tumor from the adjacent bone. Next is periosteal osteosarcoma, which is again a rare variant of osteosarcoma, which arises from surface. It is of intermediate grade between conventional osteosarcoma and paraosteal osteosarcoma. The third category of tumors includes hematopoietic and medullary neoplasts, and this category includes Ewing sarcoma, multiple myeloma, solitary plasmacytoma of bone, and primary non-Hodgkin lymphoma of bone. So let's discuss Ewing sarcoma. Ewing sarcomas are seen as ill-defined osteolytic lesion with multi-layered periosteal reaction. And these lesions are generally seen in less than 20 years of age, predominantly seen in the diaphysis of long bones, but they can also be seen in flat bones like iliac, plate and ribs. Patients generally present with pain, swelling and fever with raised ESR. Differential diagnosis include osteosarcoma, leukemia, eosinophilic granuloma, and osteomyelitis. It is the only tumor which mimics infection. Next is multiple myeloma, which is the most common primary bone tumor in elderly patients. It is seen as sharply demarcated lytic areas in axial skeleton, or there can be presence of diffuse demineralization. In the skull, we can see multiple osteolytic areas are seen of varying sizes, and this condition, this radiographic picture is known as raindrop skull. Multiple myelomas are characterized by proliferation of plasma cells. So these malignant plasma cells are seen throughout the body with systemic involvement, and patients can have brain stones, proteinuria with amyloidosis and renal failure. Differential diagnosis of multiple myeloma includes metastasis from various primaries. Next is solitary plasmacytoma of bone, which is characterized by a single osteolytic lesion which is filled with plasma cells, proliferated plasma cells. It is differentiated from multiple myeloma in which there is systemic involvement, but in solitary plasmacytoma of bone, only a particular location in the bone is involved. And solitary plasmacytoma can also be seen in the extraskeletal site in the soft tissue. Next is primary non-Hodgkin lymphoma of bone, which are characterized by ill-defined permeative osteolytic lesion in the bone. The fourth category of tumors include osteoclastic tumor or giant cell tumors, which are seen as well-defined osteolytic lesion which are classically located in the epiphysis, and they can have, they are generally seen as having a narrow zone of transition. However, they can have a poor or wide zone of transition as well. They are generally seen in patients with age group 20 to 40 years, and they are seen after fusion of epiphysis. The favorite location is around knee joint or in the distal radius, and differential diagnosis includes unusual bone cysts in younger age group. So there are four characteristic radiographic features which characterizes the giant cell tumor, and the four radiographic features are, first is patients have closed growth plate. So like in this patient, we can see the growth plate is closed, and it, the lesion abuts the articular surface. So here we can see it is abutting the articular surface, and it has a non-sclerotic rim. Here we can see there is no sclerosis in the rim, and the lesions are mainly eccentric and expansive. Next category of tumor include notochordal tumors or chordomas. So notochordal tumors and chordomas are uncommon malignant tumors of axial skeleton, and they originate from embryonic remnants of primitive notochords. These tumors are locally aggressive, and they are seen in adults of middle and elderly age groups. Classic location is sacrococcygeal region, most commonly seen in sacrococcygeal region, followed by spino-occipital areas. And tumor can have internal irregular calcification. Major differential diagnosis is chondrosarcoma. So if the lesion is located in the midline, it is more likely a chordoma, and if the lesion is located paramidline or off midline, then it is most likely chondrosarcoma. Next category of tumors include vascular tumors, which are hemangioma, epithelioid hemangioma, and angiosarcoma. So primary intraosseous hemangioma are most commonly seen in skull and vertebra, and they are generally benign, but in rare circumstances they can have locally aggressive nature. In such cases they can cause compression over vital structures, they can cause compression over spinal cord in spine. So in spine they are characterized by prominent trabecular pattern, and in skull they are characterized by spoke wheel appearance. Next is lipogenic and epithelial tumors. So, what are lipomas? Lipomas are rare benign lesions, predominantly seen in lower limb, and it is basically the most common calcaneal bone lesion. So, here we can see the presence of lipoma in the calcaneum, and it has a central calcification, which is known as pocket sign. In femur, it can be seen in the intertrochanteric region. Next is adamantinoma, which is a rare primary malignant bone tumor, which is exclusively seen in tibia in young adults. In rare circumstances, it can metastasize to distant locations like lungs, and it is seen as multilocular expansile osteolytic cortical lesion. Next category of tumors include tumors of undetermined origin. These include aneurysmal bone cyst, simple bone cyst, fibrous dysplasia, osteofibrous dysplasia, and Langerhans cell histiocytosis. So the first is aneurysmal bone cyst, which is characterized by benign expansile tumor in metaphysis of long bone in adolescent age group. It can also be seen in flat bones and spine. On radiograph, it has a soap bubble appearance because of presence of blood-filled spaces separated by thin bony septa. On MRI, it can show presence of fluid level. Differential diagnosis include giant cell tumor, fibrous dysplasia, and telangiectasic osteosarcoma. Next is simple bone cyst, also known as unicameral bone cyst. It is a common benign non-neoplastic cystic lesion seen in children. It is most commonly seen in metaphysis of proximal humerus followed by femur. It is central in location and can present with complications like pathological fracture. Like in this case, you can see the simple bone cyst is complicated by pathological fracture, And if there is presence of pathological fracture, the fragment will settle down into the most dependent location because of unique temporal nature of the cyst. Next is fibrous dysplasia, which is characterized by presence of non-neoplastic tumor-like congenital condition in which bone is replaced by fibrous stroma. It can be monoostotic or polyostotic. It can cause bending of the bone, like in this case the femur is bent, and this is known as Shepherd croup deformity. It can also affect bones of skull and face. The patient can present with craniofacial fibrous dysplasia, and it is mostly seen in children and young adults, and it leads to bone expansion and remodeling. Next is osteofibrous dysplasia, which is a rare benign fibro-osteous cortical lesion, which is almost exclusively seen in tibial cortex, and this condition is mainly seen in less than 10 years of age, and patients generally present with lytic lesion in the cortex. Next is Langerhans-Cell histiocytosis, which is a rare multisystem disorder seen in young children, and these lesions generally affect axial skeleton. In skull, they have, the lesions are multiple punched out defects with beveled edges. And the lesions are also described as geographic skull, and it can cause collapse of the vertebral body and lead to vertebral plana. So this was all about WHO classification of bone tumors. I hope you have enjoyed the video. Thank you.